Make me whole. Please restore my soul and make me whole. Here's my heart. Here's my soul.
To Luke's gospel, if you would please, chapter 19, verse 30. What we're going to do this morning is I'm going to share on this particular text, and I'm going to then really go over to the Old Testament, because I'm going to connect the two. And here's what it says. Today I'm going to read out of the NIV again, and it says these words. Go to the village ahead of you. Jesus is giving a command to his disciples. And as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there. Everybody say, a donkey tied there. Now, for the sake of sanctity, I will not read this scripture out of the New King James. Some of you didn't get that. And that's okay. But in other words, what is Jesus saying? He tells the disciples, I want you to go over to the village and get something that's tied up. Everybody say, tied up.
Tied up.
Now I have to tell you something about what it means to be tied up. Now why do you think that donkey was tied up? That donkey was tied up because if you didn't tie it up, it would run off. That donkey was tied up because it didn't understand authority. That donkey was tied up because it didn't understand to obey the commands. It was all bound up. But church, I want to tell you something. You're looking at somebody that was a tied up donkey.
Come on. Amen.
Are you hearing me? Yes. That I was a tied up donkey. But notice what it says. It says that it doesn't even say not only tied up, but one has never been ridden. Everybody say never been ridden.
Never been ridden.
Wait a minute, Jesus. You mean to tell me that you want us to go untie a donkey that nobody could ride, which means that donkey had a reputation. Come on. That anybody that tried to sit on that donkey would buck that person off. Jesus, we can get you a tame donkey, a peaceful donkey, a nice donkey. But church, how many know that when God has an assignment on your life,
yeah.
It doesn't matter what your past has been like. It doesn't matter if you couldn't submit to authority. It couldn't matter if you were in a crisis. He says that one that never has been ridden. Now, why would God want to ride on a donkey that has never been ridden? Well, I'll tell you why. Because when the presence of God rests on something that nobody else could control, how many know that that donkey is not going to buck Jesus off? Because the weight of God's glory is greater than the weight of sin. The greater? Oh, church. Let me give you an example.
Come on.
In 2 Samuel, the 6th chapter, King David, what begins to happen? King David is sitting in his palace. Everything that God's fulfilled in his life has come to pass. Every prophetic word. He is now king. He has authority. He's destroyed his enemies. Israel is having economic blessing. But there's something missing in his kingdom. He's missing the presence of God. Because you can have good leadership. You can have victories over your enemies and economic blessings. But if you don't have the presence of God, you're missing the most vital thing in your life. Come on.
Amen.
You can have a big church. You can have successful leadership. But if you do not have the presence of God, you don't have the life. Are you hearing me? Because, church, I can tell you, we just went to Birmingham to a leadership meeting, and I praise God for all the leadership tools that are available. But, church, I desperately know this. Without the presence of God, all you're going to have is just money. I don't want just money. I want the presence of God. It's only the presence of God that can deliver. It's only the presence of God that can save. And David killed giants.
Come on.
Right.
Yes. You can kill giants without the presence of God if you have a weapon power.
Yeah.
David's won battles, but David understands something. We've got to have the presence of God.
Yes.
I want the presence of God to be the center of everything that we do. And the Ark of the Covenant, everybody say Ark of the Covenant.
Ark of the Covenant.
The Ark of the Covenant is a representation of God's manifest presence. It actually was a box of furniture, a piece of furniture for those of you that don't know. Inside that box was three things. Inside that box was the rod, Aaron's rod that budded. In other words, what happened was there was this dead stick. But when a dead stick was put next to the presence of God,
come on.
Now we know that we were dead in our sin. We were dead in our life. But when we get next to the presence of God, they laid Aaron's rod, Aaron's stick, Aaron's staff next to the presence of God. And the next morning they woke up and it budded, it blossomed, and it bloomed. In other words, and bore almonds. Prior to you being saved, you had no fruit. Come on. But once you laid your life down at the presence of God's cross, come on, that now there was fruit in your life.
Amen.
That was inside the box. What else was inside the box was the manna that had been preserved. Also in the box was the book of the law, the Ten Commandments. That was in the box. And this particular ark has a history. Because I know to tell you something about the history. You don't play with God's presence.
Come on.
You don't manipulate God and tell him what he has to do. Come on. That if you don't have a relationship with God, no matter if you got Israel tried to use the box to be just bring victory and change their circumstances. You cannot use God just to change your circumstances and get what you want. Are you hearing what I'm saying? You couldn't just look in that box. You had to respect that box. You had to respect the presence of God. The people of God looked into it and they died because they weren't looking to love him. They weren't looking to worship. They just were curious. The enemy took captive the box, and the enemy put God in their temple called Dagon. For those of you that do not know what a Dagon is, it's actually a mermaid. And the Bible says they put the Ark of the Covenant next to the into their temple. How many know that God doesn't have competitors?
Amen.
And when people try to compete with God, at the end of the day, God's going to win.
Amen.
And when they came back, guess what happened? Dagon's head was cut off. And then the next day, so they put it back up. And the next day, not only was Dagon's head cut off, but his trunk was head off. He had missed an arm, and it was there across the hall, which means that when we try to compete with God, God's going to show who's boss.
Amen.
Are you hearing what I'm saying? But David, and during David's time, the Ark of the Covenant was not in the temple. It was actually out in the woods. And I'm thinking in my mind, what is the presence of God doing in the woods? Because there was a leader named Saul that wanted prestige. He wanted power, but he wasn't going after the presence. So God raised up David, and David tells his men, you know what I want to do? What we want to do is we want to go get the presence of God. We want to get the ark because we want the presence of God to be the center of everything that we do.
Amen.
So what they do is this. They then build a cart. They put the Ark of the Covenant on a new cart. Everybody say new cart.
New cart.
You've got to see this. You got to see this. Church, I'm old school.
Come on.
Come on.
I love technology. I love what's available to us. But I know something. It isn't technology that's going to bring the rule of God. It isn't some new idea. Are you hearing what I'm saying? It isn't some new philosophy. Because God isn't going to rest on technology. He wants to rest on people.
Come on.
Are you hearing what I'm saying? He wants people to carry his presence.
Amen.
Just remember the donkey. He says, go untie the donkey. Where are the donkey that he's untying? Come on. Why? Because that donkey had an assignment, right?
Yeah.
Even though that donkey had never been ridden, come on, that nobody can control it. The jail couldn't control it. The social worker couldn't control it. Their parents couldn't control it. But when God rests on that donkey,
yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
So David decides to put the presence of God on something mechanical, something man-made. When you do that, you step out of God's law. You step out of God doing things, even though their intention was right. So what happens? They put the Ark of the Covenant on the new cart. And as they're taking it to Jerusalem, they're doing something very religious. They're worshiping and they're doing what they know, but they're not doing it with the right obedience, with perfect obedience.
Right.
So what happens is the Bible says that the new cart, the cart stumbled because all that's man-made stumbles.
Amen. Amen.
Yes.
Church, the president can't turn the country around.
Right.
Only the presence of God can turn the
Amen.
Country around.
Yes.
All our good ideas, all our political jargon can't turn things around. But church, I appreciate this country. I love this country. But one thing I know. What happened when that ark stumbled, the cart stumbled, Uzzah, good intentions, reaches out and tries to steady the presence of God. How do we know that God doesn't need anybody to help him?
Come on.
That's why we don't need to be entertained. I didn't come to church to get entertained.
Come on.
I came to get changed.
Amen.
Amen.
So he reaches out, right intention, but not perfect obedience. And so when he reaches out and touches the ark, all of a sudden he dies on the spot. Because I hear a lot of folks saying, I want revival. I want awakening. But I can tell you this. When the power of God really shows up, the flesh is going to die. Flesh is going to die. Come on, are you hearing what I'm saying? There's a lot of people that want a move of God, but they don't want the flesh to die. And so now Uzzah is dead right on the spot. Now everybody is afraid of the presence of God because now the presence of God is killing the flesh. Oh, come on. Because you can't have a move of God and still have flesh. So you got to see this. So that means they can't just leave the Ark of the Covenant out in the middle of the road because it's going to kill people.
Mm-hmm.
That means that they've got to find a house.
Yeah.
They've got to find a place. They've got to find a person. Oh, come on.
Yeah.
They've got to find a church.
Yes.
That will house the presence of God.
Yeah.
Church, I think I came to the right church this morning. I think I came to the right church. We don't want to live the presence of God out there in the woods. We want the presence of God in our house. Now, we've already established that the Ark of the Covenant is a piece of furniture.
Amen.
So I want you to picture this in your mind. So David and his men have to find a house. To house the presence of God. That means they went knocking on doors. How do I know that? Revelation 3:20. Behold, I stand at the door and knock.
Yes.
If any man opens the door,
yes.
I'll come in and eat with him and
yes.
eat with me.
Yes.
In other words, God knocks on the door. Because why? He wants to come in.
Yes.
Come on, come in. I'm gonna dwell with you. I'm gonna eat with you. I'm gonna fellowship
yes.
with you. I wanna be the center of your house.
Yes, oh God.
Wow.
Yes.
Oh, come on.
Yes, oh God. Come on.
Church, we may not do anything right. We may not sing it right. We may not play it right. We may not preach it right. But there's one thing we want to do. We want God's presence to be the center of this house.
Yes.
They went knocking on doors.
Yes.
Is there anybody in Israel? Is there anybody in Aaronburg? Is there anybody in Blythe? Is there anybody in Arizona that will house the presence of God?
Yes. Oh,
hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Get here this. Knock on the door. Now, ladies and gentlemen, if I were to go over to your house, when I opened your door and walked into your house, I would discover in your house, you probably have furniture.
Amen.
And you have a couch, have a table, coffee table, probably got a TV set, some computers, right at your house, China. So they knock on the first door. Guy opens the door. He's and David and his man say, "Will you take the presence of God?" But the guy looks into his house, and he just stood in line for 4 hours at Best Buy to get a TV set.
Come on.
Are you hearing me? On Black Friday. Come on. He got a $4,000 TV set for $400. Are you hearing what I'm saying? And guess what? Just like everybody else, he's got a lot of furniture in his house. There's a lot of clutter in the house. Come on. Oh, come on. The house gets crowded this time of year. There's a Christmas tree that normally is not there. Come on. There's presents under the tree. There's decorations all over the house. Are you hearing me? But now he gets a knock on the door. And this is the presence of God. Oh, but he says, "Well, I love Jesus. I come to church on Sunday, but you know what? I really don't have room in my house for some more furniture."
Oh my God.
Which means that individual is not willing to rearrange his life.
Come on.
In order to house the presence of God. Church, I think I came to the right house today. One thing I want to do when God's knocking on my door, I want to rearrange my lifestyle in order to house the presence of God. That means if I got to get rid of some furniture this morning, I'm going to get rid of some furniture. If I got to sell the TV set, I'm going to sell the TV. Let's see this. So he tells his man, "Now, I got just I'm too crowded. Besides, I just bought that flat screen TV and I
come on.
Bought the new cable and then I bought a new Nintendo for my kids. So we just don't have time to rearrange our life because we love God but we don't love Him that much."
Ooh.
Oh Lord, help us.
Ooh.
So David and his men, okay, you go to the next house. Knock on the door. The people are in the house, but they don't answer the door.
Come on.
Because you know what? They've got furniture. The problem is they got stuff in their house they don't want the presence of God to see.
Mm. Oh, yes.
Come on.
You know what I'm saying? And if the presence of God comes in the house, guess what's going to happen then?
Light.
There's stuff on the computer that you shouldn't be looking at. There's stuff under the bed that you shouldn't be there. There's some excess stuff in there in the house that shouldn't be there. So guess what I'll do? I'll pretend like I'm not home.
Come on.
Now, church, that happens right when you're preaching to somebody. Come on. Mm-hmm. I'll just not, they're not home. They're not home. Why? Because there's stuff. They're so crowded. Come on. And they know that they got stuff in the house that they want to hang on to. Come on, church. Yeah. When God's knocking on my door, He says, "Will you get have a garage sale? Get rid of it. Get rid of it. Well, the next house they go to, they knock on the door, and they knock on the door of a man by the name of Obed-Edom. Everybody say Obed-Edom.
Obed-Edom.
The word Obed-Edom in the Hebrew actually means servant worshiper. Oh, come on!
Yeah.
Not just somebody who likes to sing.
Yeah.
Not just somebody who loves music. I'm talking about somebody who serves and somebody who worships.
Amen.
Which means real worship is serving others. Oh, come on. Serving God and serving people. Come on. That's what real worship. So they knock on the door of the servant worshiper's house, Obed-Edom. For those of you that may not be aware, Obed-Edom, I heard this from a rabbi, that Obed-Edom was a black man. He knocked on the door. And Obed-Edom opened the door. Obed-Edom saw the Ark of the Covenant and understood the value of his presence.
Hallelujah.
Oh, Obed-Edom had furniture just like everybody else. Come on. He had a TV. He had computer. He had stuff in his house. He had his Christmas tree. He had all that. But when God knocked on his door, when God knocked on his door, he turned to his sons and said, "Boys, I want you to get rid of that flash drive. Turn that Nintendo off right now. Get rid of that computer. We've got to make room for the presence of God in our house. The presence of God that is so important. Traditionalist. But sometimes we can be so traditional that we forget the most important thing isn't our tradition, it is the presence of God. Are you hearing me? The reason the Pharisees could not receive Jesus is because of their tradition. So God had to send three wise men from another country to worship Jesus. I praise God that Obadiah didn't recognize what was knocking on his door.
Yes.
And was willing to rearrange his lifestyle, his plans, his time.
Yes.
To host the presence of God.
Yes, oh God.
Now, church, it's very interesting. Because now they find a home.
Jesus.
I believe God's knocking on the door of this church.
Yes, Jesus.
I believe He's knocking on the door of our heart. He's knocking on the door of this city.
Yes.
And He's looking for some obedience.
Yes.
Some servant worshipers.
Yes, Jesus.
You say, I don't care if I stand in line for 4 hours at Best Buy and drove to Phoenix to get it. The presence of God's coming to my house.
Yes.
This piece of furniture is more important than my furniture.
Amen. Yes, Jesus.
Get rid of that coffee table. Get rid of grandma's china. We got
come on.
Get rid of that relic that was passed down from your uncle.
Yes.
Right now, the presence of God, and put the presence of God, give me the center. In our living room.
Yes, oh God. Thank God. Yes, oh
now,
God.
Now, what's amazing about that, in fact, we're going to keep your finger on Luke 19. Go all the way over to 2 Samuel 6. And just give me a second. I can do this. Because I want you to see this. This is so powerful.
Amen.
2 Samuel 6. And this is what it says. Why don't you look at verse 10? It says that, he's talking about David, he was not willing to take the ark of the Lord to be within the city of David. Instead, he took it to the house of Obed-Edom the Gittite. Now look at verse 11. The ark of the Lord remained. Everybody say, remained. In other words, when it came in Obed-Edom's house, it wasn't killing people anymore.
Right.
It stayed there.
Yes.
Why? Because there was a house that was honoring him, a house that was respecting him, a house that was worshiping him, a house that was obeying him, a house that was loving him.
Yes. Mm.
What happened? I'm going to stay in that house.
Amen.
In other words, Obed-Edom gave him no excuse to leave the house. He said it remained. Now notice this. In the house of Obed-Edom, the Gittite, for 3 months. This is amazing. And the Lord blessed him and his entire household. Now, sometimes we can read through that real fast instead of sitting back, pushing the pause button, and say, what does that look like? That means before the presence of God, Obed-Edom's what house wasn't as blessed, but when the presence of God came in, something transformed inside his house.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Now, I don't know about you, but how many want your house blessed?
Amen.
How many want your kids blessed? It's a little bit and his entire household.
Yes.
Now, you've got to understand this. What that meant is to be blessed, because how many know if you don't have your health, you're not blessed? That means that when Obed-Edom rearranged his lifestyle to house the presence of God, the presence of God came with power. That means everybody in Obed-Edom's house was healed. There was no sickness in Obed-Edom's house. Because when the presence of God moved in, cancer bowed the knee. Diabetes bowed the knee. Depression bowed the knee. Oh, hear me. And it says his entire household. So that means everybody connected to the house of Obed-Edom. Yeah. That means that when people walked on the property,
come on,
church, all of a sudden they walked on the property and got hit with the power of God. That means go to Obed-Edom's house and you'll get healed. Come to Faith for Life and you'll get through it. That's what happens here. So, not only that, supernatural power is breaking out. Nobody's depression, there's joy in the house. Come on.
Amen.
That means that because it's an agricultural community, that means that Obed-Edom had land. They would grow fruits and vegetables and all the things that the farm life would have. That means that his farm laborers, when they walked in the pocket, boom!
Yes.
You just broke your ankle. You step on Obed-Edom's house. And we'll start working on his property. God heals you instantaneously. Not only that, was God supernatural power working? But all of a sudden, he said it was there for 3 months. That's 90 days.
Yes.
Come on. 90 days. Was there for 3 months. During that 3 months, when it says being blessed by biblical standards, is this: that Obed-Edom went from being broke to being a billionaire.
Come on.
Church, I'm not a prosperity preacher, but I know that God wants to prosper everybody.
Amen.
You know what I'm saying? Why? Because Deuteronomy 8:18 says, I give you the power to create wealth. Come on. To create wealth. So if you're not wealthy, and what I mean about wealthy is not only economically, you're wealthy in your mind.
Come on.
You're wealthy in your spirit.
Amen.
You're wealthy in your speech. You're wealthy in your physical body. Everything about you oozes out and demonstrates the wealth of God's blessing. Now, why do I want to be wealthy? No, not the house I live in or the car that I drive. It's so that he said, I give you the power to create wealth so you might establish my covenant upon the earth. Hear me. Why? So we can establish the kingdom on the earth. That's why we want to be wealthy. Not so we can get a Learjet, fly over, and live the high life, but so that we can establish the kingdom of God. Because I will tell you this, it's like this. Back in first part of July, I don't have time to get into it, it's a long story. A month prior, I get a call of a lady in Chicago who was setting up meetings, three-day meetings during the week in Chicago, because she's Lithuanian, and said, Brother Harkey, I had a dream that you weren't in Chicago with us, that you were in Lithuania. I said, that's wonderful. And I believe that you're not to come to Chicago. This was in May. I was scheduled with her first late June, early July. She said, I saw you in my country in Lithuania. I said, I know you did, but you didn't see me a month from now. Well, long story short, I landed in Lithuania. Wow. Now, when I landed in Lithuania, it was on a Monday. I left on Sunday and landed on Monday. I left Sunday, Central Time, 6 o'clock, and landed at 2 o'clock in the afternoon on Monday. And when I landed there, the Spirit of God came on me, and I went to an all-women's maximum security prison. They told me they want me to prophesy over these ladies. They said there was going to be about 40 people, 40 ladies, and there was 150. And they told me I had 2 hours. How many know to pray over somebody for 2 hours, you need the supernatural help? Well, 2 hours came and went, and I hadn't prayed all over them, and then the guard came in, the woman guard came in to escort the prisoner ladies out. But when she came in, I wasn't done. So what I did is I called the female guard up to the front. There was a little platform. I called her up and started prophesying over her.
Come on.
When I prophesied over her, she fell out under the power of God.
Hallelujah.
2 hours. Come on.
Wow.
And I got to pray for every one of those ladies. At the end, I gave an altar call, and 65 ladies gave their hearts to Jesus. An amazing trip, and then we're going back there because we believe that God wants us to start a school of ministry there next year. And I said all that because church without wealth, is what I mean by wealth. That when you're wealthy, that means when you walk in here and somebody walks in depressed, you've got the word from God to pick them up. That's the wealth that I'm talking about. That means when somebody walks in here sick because of the wealth of God in your life, you lay your hands on them and the wealth of God flows through your life and touches another person. That's the wealth I'm talking about. To establish a covenant. But actually, that word wealth in the Hebrew, this is what it means. It means that God will give you an army to establish your dreams.
Amen.
Yes. How many want an army to establish your dream? Yes. That God will send an army to help you establish your dream.
Amen.
That church is saying he blessed his house. He blessed his house. Well, he went from being broke to being a billionaire. Mm-hmm. So that means he can send his kids to college. Mm-hmm. He can send his grandkids to college.
Come on.
And pay for the whole thing.
Amen.
And church, guess what happened? This went on for 3 months. And now Obed-Edom's house started to get a reputation. Mm-hmm. That around the community, everybody was saying, wow, Obed-Edom's house, his kids are blessed, his marriage is blessed, his relationships are blessed, his fields is blessed. He's blessed with the presence of God. This man is so wealthy. Why? The presence of God's in his house.
Yeah.
Well, think about this. We have a new president. Obed-Edom gets such a reputation that some of David's men hear about it all the way in Jerusalem.
Yeah.
So one of David's advisors approaches the king and says, King, have you heard?
Yeah.
Have you heard how God has blessed the house of Obed-Edom?
Yeah.
Now this is what would it be like. This is exactly what it'd be like. It'd be like If one of the advisors to President Donald Trump walked into his office and said, I'm sorry to interrupt you, Mr. President, but have you heard about a town called Ehrenberg, Arizona? Have you heard about a house called Faith for Life? Do you know that everybody in that house is being blessed by God? That their relationships are blessed. They're blessed economically. There's so much creativity in that house. There's health. There's wealth. There's all the Lord has blessed the house. I must tell you that the church hasn't got the reputation that Obed-Edom's house got. The church, that's the Old Testament. My Bible says, you who being evil know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven? Oh, come on! Good gifts. If he's been in the Old Testament, how much more does he want to be in the New? I'm just looking for people to open the door and make it in. Have you heard about it? Have you heard about it? So they went into this explanation of explaining what the blessing looked like to the king. And when the king goes, oh my gosh, we got to go get it. Because, let me tell you something about a real leader. A real leader just goes up and one of his houses blessed. A real leader wants every house blessed.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes.
So David said, I want what's happening in Obed-Edom's house to happen in my nation.
Yes. Think about it.
To be honest with you,
yes, Jesus.
I want what's happening in this house to happen in the next one.
Yes. Why not? Yes.
Amen. So they go to Obed-Edom's house. They want the ark back. Mm-hmm. Church, I have to tell you this. You know, I'm Obed-Edom, right? They come knocking on the door. This is his name. They knock on the door. And Obed-Edom opens his house. Everything he's touching there and being blessed. And David and his men say, hey, Obed-Edom, we heard about how God blessed you the last 90 days.
Come on.
We want the ark back.
Come on.
I said, oh man, I'm keeping it.
Come on.
You're the one that gave it up. Come on. You're the one that didn't want the presence of God. You're the one that was afraid of the presence of God. You didn't want it. I'm here. You think that I'm going to give up 90 days of blessing? You think that I'm going to relinquish something so sacred, something so powerful as the presence of God? You're out of your mind. Oh, hear me. Because, hey, you're the one that didn't treat it right. You didn't carry it right. You didn't honor him. You didn't obey him. You just used him to manipulate. And I'm here. I'm the Holy One. Look at my kids, man. They're all geniuses. Come on, church. Are you hearing? I'm going to give that up.
Bless you, God.
Absolutely not. I'm going to hang on to it. 3 months isn't very long.
Yeah, revival.
90 days of revival.
Yeah, blessings.
And blessing, and healing, and miracles, and signs, and wonders. You see, Obed-Edom isn't like everybody else.
Right.
Obed-Edom is different. He's a servant. Worshipper.
Yes.
And servant worshipers beat to the sound of a different
drum. Yes.
Here he had been experienced the greatest blessing of his entire life. Nobody had ever heard of him.
That's right.
He's got a reputation in the nation. He's famous.
Jesus.
He's famous for housing.
Jesus, yes, oh God.
And now they want it back. But see, Obed-Edom understood something very clearly. Would you hear me? God doesn't just bless us from us.
Right.
He doesn't just move into our house just for us.
Right.
Just so that you and I could experience a life of blessing. He does it because he wants to do something. He wants to duplicate. He wants us to release what he has given us. Come on. To a nation. Come on, church. See, when I'm selfish, what I do is I hang on to the people. I hang on to my little piece of the pie. Come on. And I don't understand generosity.
Yeah.
Let me tell you something about generosity. Generosity restores dignity to people. It gives them back their identity.
Come on.
Because what? As a nation, Israel had lost their identity. They lost their dignity. How many know America is on the verge of losing her identity and her dignity in the nation? Come on. We need somebody. Notice this. What is he doing? I mean, that means there's a possibility that if I give you the Ark of the Covenant, I may not experience what I've been experiencing the last 90 days. The church of God would never do that. Give, and it shall be given. crushed down, shaken together, and running over. Men will pour into your bosom.
Jesus.
Are you hearing what I'm saying? Because the greatest expression of love is giving.
Yes. Yes.
You want to come out of your poverty? Start giving.
Yes.
I mean, I'm not just not economically. Give your time. Give your energy. Give your resources. Give your time. Give God everything. Give Him first. Seek Him first. The kingdom of God and all His righteousness and all these things shall be added unto you. In other words, you display generosity, something will happen.
Yes.
Oh, hear me. I wasn't planning on sharing this, but I'm going to share it.
Yes.
How many know that Hannah was empty? Come on. She was empty. She was so empty. And she's being provoked in her whole old house. Come on.
Yes.
Because back in back in the day, if you were a woman and didn't have children, they could divorce you. Because they had what we call social assumptions about people's value.
Yeah.
And we based a woman's value based on childbearing. And now Hannah has no children. Come on. You know what? And guess what? And she's now in a house, and there's a woman that actually says her adversary, Peninnah, is reminding her every day of how empty she is. How many know the devil doesn't come to remind you how God wants to fill you? He reminds you of how empty you are, how you don't have anything. Come on, inside of you. And so she's living with that. Then when she goes to church, the preacher belittles her too and calls her a drunk. Because the preacher can't see past what he can see because Eli had lost his vision. So she goes to church, she's at home, she's being belittled, she goes to church, she's belittled. But she had a husband by the name of Elkanah.
Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
And in 1 Samuel 1:5, it says, Elkanah, he did this. And Elkanah gave Hannah a double portion.
Yeah.
Now, church, why in the world would you give somebody who's empty double portion?
The feeling.
Because I know something. In business, you don't invest it into something unless you want to get a return. That'd be foolish.
Yeah.
In other words, why would you invest into a woman who had no children? Why invest in Ehrenberg, Arizona? Many times in the kingdom, God doesn't look at the outward. In the kingdom, God invests people who don't bear fruit.
Come on.
Because something happens when you're a recipient of generosity. Something happens to you. Something happens to your heart. Because how many know when someone gives to you and you know you're not deserving, then there's an appreciation. You want to give back to them. Come on.
Yes.
You want to do something for them because they have been so kind to you.
Yeah.
And so he said he gave her a double portion because he loved her.
Yeah.
Everybody say loved her.
Loved her.
Well, in other words, whether you give me a son or not, I'm still going to pour into your life.
Amen.
How many thankful that God still pours into your life? Not because of what you can give them, come on, but because of love and love alone. Our brother read the scripture out of 1 Corinthians 13 about love this morning. And you know what? Because church, because he was saying, you know what? Whether you bear a son to me, whether you give me children or not, I'm still going to pour into you. Now, when I believe that when Elkanah did that to Hannah, it sparked something.
Yes.
It sparked something in her heart.
Yes.
God, you didn't have to use my husband to bless me. You didn't have to pour into my life. But what I want to do is I want to rearrange my lifestyle. I want to house your presence. I want to give you back. Oh, come on. What you gave me.
Yes.
And I believe to spark something that's here, the crazy thing. It says, the 1 Samuel 1:5, Elkanah gave it up with portion, even though he loved her, even though the Lord clothed her womb. You mean the Lord clothed her womb? He said, you didn't say that physically she could have children.
No.
He said, the Lord clothed her.
Yeah.
So the Lord allowed her not to have children. What's up with that? But what happened? Generosity opened that womb.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah, Jesus.
Because it caused Hannah to get desperate on the inside.
Yes.
Because until we get desperate on the inside, we live empty on the inside.
Yes. Yes.
And what happens is, I believe that that gift caused Hannah to say, I want to give my son, I want to give my husband a son, God. I can't live without a son. I'm going to make some crazy vows, some crazy prayers. Come on. I'm going to give him back to you. And that's exactly what happened. So here comes David. Let me get back to Obed-Edom. And here comes, knocking on the door. And Obed-Edom doesn't get an attitude. He doesn't get upset with David. He doesn't say, you gave it. What he says is, here, take the ark. Here, give it back to you. You know why? Because he wanted what he'd been experiencing the last 90 days. Come on. He wanted his nation to experience that. He wanted his king to experience that.
Yeah.
I want to tell you something right now. Church, I want to say this. I'm going to say this, but I've never said this publicly. If Hillary Clinton was the president right now, I'd want her blessed.
Yes.
I may not agree
right.
with some of her decisions, but I would want her blessed.
Yes.
Are you hearing what I'm saying?
Yes.
But I know believers that if she was the president, they put some nasty stuff that unsaved folks don't even talk about. Come on their social media because they don't like what she does. Instead of saying, you know what? Well, that means that when you don't have the presence of God, you have nothing to give. Woo! Oh, come on. All you can give is your opinions. All you can give is your anger. All you can give is a political spirit. When you have the presence of God. Well, David, I didn't vote for you and your man. I don't care. Just because I didn't vote for you doesn't mean I don't want you blessed. On one side of the tracks and I lived on the other side of the tracks doesn't mean that I want you blessed. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Because we got a culture in America that wants to hold on to its stuff. Come on. Wants to hold on to its blessing. Church, you know what it means to be poor in spirit? Because my Bible says, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. What it means to be poor in spirit. I'm not saying that you live out in the hole, in a cave. I'm talking about you understand that it was grace that knocked on your door. It was all grace that came into your house. It was all grace that blessed you. Come on. It wasn't you. It wasn't your prayer life. It wasn't your mama. It wasn't where you grew up. It was the grace of God. Make me your prime minister.
Come on.
Put me next to your throne. No. Give me half of Israel. Give me.
No.
Now, Obed-Edom, man, he's a servant worshiper.
He's a servant.
Hallelujah.
Jesus. Jesus, help us, Lord.
See, when you're a servant worshiper, generosity isn't a thought, it's a lifestyle.
Yes, it is.
Amen.
Yes, Lord.
I know I'm preaching wrong, but I need to say this.
Come on.
See, when you're a servant worshiper, how many know that when Jesus, how many know that when Jesus healed lepers, I mean, he laid his hands, and let me tell you something about leprosy. Leprosy is unlike any disease known to man. Usually, we can cure problems in our bodies because we feel pain. So we go to the doctor runs a test. You say, Dr. Messiah, and he looks at it and he makes a diagnosis. But leprosy cuts your ability, your body's ability to feel pain. So people with leprosy can go to bed at night, and then a little rat can chew off their foot, and they can wake up and really not feel a thing and say, oh, my foot's missing, my toes are missing. That's how bad it is. So when you talk about Jesus healing lepers, it's not just the skin pigmentation. That means that when he laid his hands on lepers, their toes grew back, their ears grew back.
Hallelujah.
Their toes grew back.
Yes.
But in this one incident, in Luke 17, Meliana, in the Bible says that he went, there was 10 lepers. There were 10 of them. And now, let me just tell you something. How many of that right now in our culture, people find commonality in their disease? We have groups, sects, right? And because why? Because we find our commonality in our struggles. So alcoholics hang around with alcoholics, right? Addicts hang around with addicts, right? Because we relate. People that have been abused, come on, they hang around with people who've been abused because we find our commonality in our pain.
Come on.
Because that person can understand what I'm going through. Come on. But so they found their commonality in their disease. So they were isolated from society. Because that gave them a sense of belonging, a community, even though they were filled with disease.
Come on.
Church, I don't want to be in a community filled with disease. I want to be in a community of freedom. Come on.
Come on.
That's what I want to be. I want to be in a community of blessing. I want my house to be blessed.
Amen.
But they cry out to God and they say, Master, heal us. Well, Jesus doesn't lay hands on them this time. He says, go show yourself to the priest. And when he says that, the Bible says that they had nothing to lose. Why? Because they were just proved to the priest that they were healed. So the Bible says that as they went, they were healed. As they obeyed, they were healed. Now I want you to see this. Many preach that. I'm not preaching that this morning. But that means that as they went, some of them got their ears back.
Amen.
Some of them all of a sudden their fingers grew back. Come on. As they went. And as they went, as they're going to the temple, things are happening in their lives. James looks at Bubba and says, Bubba, you got a brand new eye. And I know. And Bubba looks at Jimmy and says, hey, Jimmy, you see that? You got brand new toes. Now you think when that happened there would be a celebration, come on, going on. They'd be leaping and dancing, right? But the Bible's and listen to me, hear me. Jesus says as they went. They says as they went. So that means that they were going to the temple. How many know that in that temple there was no presence? The presence of God was not in that temple, right? But sometimes I've noticed this, that there are people who come to church. They come to church, they get their prophecy, they get their prayer, they get their light bill paid for.
Come on.
Oh, come on. Yeah. And then they just keep living their life. They just keep right on going, living their life. Keep right on going. Meanwhile, the presence of God ain't in that temple where they're going. They had just left the presence of God. But they keep right on living their life. They came to church. They got the demons cast out. But then they go back to where they go. Oh, come on, church. Are you hearing me? It happens right here. Pastor, I can't pay my rent. And so we take an offering. We take it out of church fund to pay the people's rent, to be a blessing and show generosity. But they just keep right on walking.
Come on.
Are you hearing what I'm saying, church? That's what happened to the people, because sometimes people come to church, well, that's all the Jesus I want. I got my healing. I got my miracle financially. I got my prophecy. And that's all the God I want. So I came to church to say that I want more than just my healing. I want more than just my prophecy. One Samaritan. There was one Samaritan.
Jesus.
One.
Yes.
One. There is a one.
Wow.
There's 10 of them, but one. One.
Only one.
One. He said, wait a minute. I know God said, show yourself to the person. I don't think that's what he said.
Yes.
I want to be obedient to God. But I don't just want to keep living my life without his presence.
Come on.
I don't want to say, now that I got my life back, now that I can assimilate into culture, now I can probably get a wife, get a married, a job, get married, and have a family now that I have never seen before.
No, yeah.
I don't want just that. I want him.
Yes.
I want the presence of God.
Yes.
Because if you really want the presence of God, there comes a time in your life that you're going to have to push the pause button sometimes.
Yes.
Just going to have to pause. And not keep running towards nowhere.
Right.
Just push the pause button.
Yes.
And reset your priorities.
Yes.
And this is what this pushes the reset button.
Mm-hmm.
On his mind. And when you push the reset button, I'm going to go to the temple.
Mm-hmm.
But right now I'm going to turn around.
Amen.
And go back to your presence.
Yes.
Because, church, we live in a culture of complaining.
Mm. Yes.
Not a culture of gratitude.
Right.
Mm.
That we can sit around the table after hearing a message like this and go back to the same conversation of complaining.
That's right.
Mm.
Let me tell you something right now. People that complain stay in the wilderness.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's right.
If you want to get out of your mess, stop complaining. Because notice this, they found their commonality in their disease.
Mm-hmm.
But they separated in their gratitude. Come on. You know what I mean?
He separated.
He brought, hey guys, let's go back and thank him. Let's go back and thank him. Let's thank God. Let's thank God. Let's thank him. He didn't have to come to our house. The arm didn't have to come to our house. Let's thank him. Let's thank him. Because my greatest act of generosity is Thanksgiving.
Yes.
Are you hearing me? Thank you. Let's not just keep going. Hey, guy! And then just keep right on walking. Well, that's all the church I want to do today. That's all the presence I want. Not the Samaritan. He turned around. Scripture says, he turned around, fell on his knees, and worshiped, and gave God gratitude.
Amen.
Now here's something amazing. I do not want you to forget this. Jesus then looks at the man as he's worshiping, and giving him gratitude for what God has done for him. And Jesus says, were there not 9 others that were healed?
Wow. Yes.
Yet this one
Samaritan
was the only one who came back to give me thanks.
Mm-hmm.
Now church, hear this. I thought Jesus said to go to the temple and show yourself to the priest.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Didn't they do what Jesus said to do? Yes, they did do what Jesus said to do. So why would Jesus say, was there not 9 others that were healed, but yet this one Samaritan came to give me gratitude?
Mm.
You know what Jesus meant by that? Does he have to tell you to be thankful?
Mm. Come on.
Does he have to remind you to live a lifestyle of thanksgiving? Shouldn't that be something that's automatic?
Yes.
Come Come on, shouldn't that be something? Do I got to remind you to praise me? Do I got to remind you to worship me? Do I got to remind you? Come on. Do I got to remind you? Or are you too busy going to church? Are you too busy doing religious stuff? Come on. Are you too busy under the tree? But aren't you? Do I have to remind you? There's only one wanting the presence. Nine others got their healing at what they came for. They blew around. Only one wanted the presence. And Jesus looks at them and says, you, because you came back and you only grabbed you, you are made whole. You, the others got healed.
Yeah.
The others might got a new finger,
yeah.
New ear, new eye, new hair, new wardrobe, but you got whole.
Yeah.
And because you, that means your mind, spirit, will, and emotions, you got whole. In other words, his house got blessed. Come on.
Yeah.
Just like Obed-Edom's. So when Obed-Edom said to David, David, you know what? I'm going to relinquish what has been blessing me. Because I want an entire Israel. I want a nation to experience what I've been experiencing the last 90 days. I want them to experience in the White House. I want them to experience every house in America. Are you hearing what I'm saying?
Amen.
And because of that, here, take the ark.
Yes.
Here. Take it. Now, church, I was wondering, because you can't give up something so valuable and have God not bless you.
Yeah, mm-hmm. That's right.
So guess what happened to Obed-Edom? You know what? David said, well, Obed, since you honored the ark, since you honored the presence of God, why don't you come and show a nation how to worship God?
Yeah.
Come on, and you'll find out that Obed-Edom was part of the team that worshiped God 24/7 in the tent. Come on, because he was his family was the only one that knew how to honor and treat the presence of God. Obed, why don't you just come with us? Which means he didn't relinquish nothing. He got a promotion. He didn't have to take care of his farm anymore. All he had to do was take care of the presence of God and worship God.
Oh. Yes, oh God. Yeah. Yes, oh God. Come
on. Yeah. Church, I got to find a conclusion and I don't want to stop. Got to hear this. Go back to Luke 19:30 and we'll close. Luke 19:30.
Yes, Jesus.
When God want a donkey? Who's ever been ridden? Why? Because that donkey had an assignment. You had an assignment.
Yes. Yes.
That is bigger than you.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
Because that donkey's assignment.
Yes.
Was to carry the presence of God into Jerusalem.
Jesus.
They've never been ridden.
Yeah.
God's going to take the most wild, wicked generation.
Yes, Jesus.
And he's going to rest on that.
Yes,
I was wild and wicked. That's my mom. But when the presence of God rests on me,
yes, oh God.
I now understood my responsibility.
Yes.
I'm to carry the presence of God.
Yes.
And the city that he's supposed to go.
Yeah.
Now check it out. Why the donkey? Why Jesus is sitting on the donkey? Guess what happens? You're resting on the donkey.
Yeah.
Jesus, you're resting on somebody like me? I know what I am.
Yeah.
Yes, I want to rest on you.
Yeah,
you're tied up, I want to rest on you. Yeah. You're bound up.
Yeah.
You're filled with doubt, fear, and unbelief.
Yeah.
I want to rest on you. What an honor.
Yes.
What a privilege that God would want to rest on human flesh.
Yes. Wow. Hallelujah. Yes, oh God.
You know me. You know me. You know my propensity to sin.
Yes.
You know my propensity. You know what I do. You know my weakness. No, I want to rest on you.
Yes, oh God.
Church, when you understand that now the donkey is carrying Jesus, oh man. If I could do anything, I want to be that donkey. I want to be that. I like being a donkey. If I could carry God. Now, how many know that when he came into God, they're shouting, Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna to the highest.
Yes.
You see, when you have an understanding that you were a tied up, rebellious donkey prior to Jesus calling you, and God's presence is resting on you, and they're jumping up at your sermons. Come on. They're falling out when you prophesy. You don't get impressed with yourself.
No.
Because they're not shouting for you.
That's right.
Yes. They were shouting for the donkey, were they? They were shouting for what's on your back, or who you're carrying. They're shouting for what you're carrying. Come on. Are you hearing what? They're not shouting about your sermon. They're shouting. They're shouting because of what you're carrying.
Yeah.
So you never get impressed. Because all praise and honor goes to him.
Yeah.
Come on. It goes right from your ears off of your ears. It bounces off your ear. It doesn't go inside your ears. Because how many know donkeys fold their ears?
Yeah.
I think some folks that are folding their ears to somebody praising you. I am hearing that. That praise belongs to God. In prayer, you got to build a new church. Because God wants to make a home in here. Come on. And if you've got 1,000 people in your church, you can fold your ear and know it wasn't us. Social services couldn't help them. But when God's presence rests on them, come on. They don't want the alcohol. They don't want the perversion. They don't want the drugs. They don't want the flat screen TV and the big house. They don't want their vacations. They want the presence of God. Nothing wrong with vacation, but they want the presence of God. Yes. Hear me. Untie it and bring it here.
Praise God.
Jesus! If we untie it, it might run off. How many know that donkeys are stubborn?
Yeah.
If we untie it, it might just sit down and not want to move.
Yeah.
What do we do? That what we do is gonna. That means we're gonna drag that thing. How many know it's very difficult to drag a donkey that drag folks, drag people who don't want to come.
Yeah.
How you know what I'm saying? Yeah. Drag. But wait. But wait. You need to do something. If they start to resist you, this is what you say. If anyone, verse 31, if anyone asks you why you are untying it, why are you delivering him? Why are you helping her? Why are you giving to them? They're alcoholics. Why are you doing that? Don't want to untie them. You're wasting your time. Church, people could have said that about me. Because why are you untying? Say, the Lord needs it.
Yes.
Amen.
Jesus. Yes. Thank you. And the Lord needs it.
Yes.
In other words, tell him the Lord needs you.
Yes.
Yes.
Tell him the Lord needs you.
Yes.
See, that donkey's ears was folded.
Yeah.
But when that donkey heard, the Lord needs you.
Yes.
Yeah.
Come on. Come on.
What?
Yeah.
You mean the Lord needs this rebellious, out of control?
Yeah. Come on.
Young man. Oh.
Hallelujah.
I'm not going to be stubborn anymore.
Yeah.
I'm not going to be resistant to authority anymore.
Yeah.
Since the Lord needs me, you don't even need to hold on to the reins. I'm walking toward his presence. You don't even need to restrain. You just show me the way, preacher.
Yes.
Show me the way, apostles, and I'll go right there. And I'll gladly submit to his lordship, and his leadership can rest on me. I won't buck him off. The Lord needs me.
Yeah.
Oh, come on, church. The Lord needs you. The Lord needs you. He needs you to carry his presence. That means you got to start bucking off your sin. You got to buck off your depression.
Yeah.
You got to buck off your stuff.
Woo-hoo!
And you got to buck off the stuff you should not be carrying.
Yeah.
So you make room so God can rest on you.
Woo-hoo!
Can we give God a shout of praise?
Yeah.
Your hands toward heaven all over the room. Father, we love your word.
We love you, Lord.
We love your presence. We love
yes,
your worship.
God.
So we walk in the spirit
yes,
of revival in this church.
Yes,
oh
God.
This is revival, the church full.
Yes.
Church full on Saturday. It's revival.
Yes.
And we thank you, Father, in the name of Jesus, for what you're going to do right now. That you're going to untie donkeys.
Yeah.
You love these weak, broken people.
Yes.
Yes. With weak, broken lives, and we love
yes,
you to display your glory on your tongue as we be like us. Thank you for listening to us.
Yes. Yes, Lord.
Today we open the door like Obadiah.
Yes, you can come, Lord.
Then when other people want to share in the blessing, we will not
yes,
hold that.
Yes.
Be generous to what you've given us.
Yes.
Because we don't want just 90 days of blessing. We want decade after decade.
Yes.
After decade.
Yes.
After decade.
Yes.
Blessing, oh God.
Yes.
Yes, oh God.
We know if we hold on to a little piece of the pie, that it gets eaten after a few years.
Yes.
When we release what you've given us,
yes,
it leaves a legacy, oh God.
Yes,
in the name
God.
Of Jesus.
Yes.
We thank you for the legacy of Obadiah and the legacy of a donkey. Yes. May I be a donkey, may I be a servant worshiper.
Yes.
In the name of Jesus.
Yes.
I would even put your hand down. I'd like Pastor Sylvia and Pastor Vaughn to come stand right here.
God.
I want to pray over them. I'd like my wife to come.
Yes,
come,
oh
if you would, please.
Hallelujah.
The Lord woke me up this morning. This morning at 5 o'clock in the morning, California time, six o'clock, Arizona time. And then he said to me, John 5.
Hallelujah.
And I know the story in John 5 of the man that had been on the pool of Bethesda for 38 years. And then Jesus, his presence shows up and he picks him up. And the Lord said, my presence is going to get so strong in this house among you, my daughter and my son, that everyone that comes in here that have never gotten their miracle will leave built up and all of a sudden that which has crippled them, and some are crippled economically, some are crippled in their mind, some are crippled emotionally, some are crippled spiritually, but this will be a season, 2017, the cripples will walk. Jesus said, pick up your mat and walk. In other words, pick up your mat and at his word. And God is putting an authority in this house unlike anything you've ever experienced in your entire lives, both of you. That when you speak the word, it is at the word, it's going to penetrate the person's soul, marrow and bone, and all of a sudden the light's going to turn on. I don't have to wait for a stirring of the water. I don't have to wait for the angel. I don't have to wait for some celestial thing to happen. God's word, spoken under authority, is picking me up. God says you're going to begin laying the foundation of a new building. That the cripple that had been by the pool of Bethesda are going to come to this church. Because the healing love of God is in this church. I'm going to give both of you the gift of leadership, the gift of discipleship. You're going to be an empowering person, a dreaming person. People are going to come so broken, but yet they're going to come. And they're going to leave this place knowing that they can fulfill their dream, saith the Lord.
Yes,
Jesus.
Yes, Lord.
Ron, I know this. You was in certain parts of the country.
Thank you, Jesus.
Because of the way you preach, the way you sing, you have a church of 1,000 people. And you get to you're in Arizona. You're out of your element. But you're my obey. You're my obey.
Yes, Father. Yes, oh God.
I'm going to give you a reputation.
Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
That is going to amaze people.
Yes, Lord.
Because God is going to build something here at Faith
Hallelujah.
When people drive through
Hallelujah.
The little village of Ehrenberg,
Hallelujah.
The most beautiful sight they're going to see is not the Colorado River. Humility and your mercy and your gift of mercy toward people who are undeserving of mercy.
Yes.
Yes, oh God.
Because you've been so merciful, even when people have been so ugly.
Yes.
Even ugly towards your husband, ugly towards God, ugly towards you. But you continue. I just got to tell you this. Every time Moses was ridiculed by his sister, by his brother Aaron, Miriam, they ridiculed him, told him he shouldn't marry the Ethiopian woman, you shouldn't have done that, then spread trash down to the community. But what did Moses do? Moses prayed for her.
Yes.
And you've interceded, daughter. Because a real leader never grows bitter. The real leader said, oh God, please don't let them have leprosy. Please heal.
Yeah.
And because you've done that, I promise you that my presence will never leave you. I will reign in your life. I will give you health and longevity and long life, says the Lord. And even though many times you don't come up, you don't preach, you just do what you have to do, you even step out of your comfort zone sometimes, God says, I'm going to honor you. I'm going to honor you because much of what you do is not seen by man or woman's eye, but it's seen by the eyes of God. And the Lord said, thank you for untying the donkeys and bringing them to me. So I can rest on them.
Yes, oh God.
Time and time again, you've even told your husband when people were sometimes cruel, you've been merciful. You said, the Lord needs them.
Thank you, Jesus.
The Lord needs them.
Thank you, Father.
God says to you, God said that he's going to put people in your path, so you know, and we're so loyal to your condition. Because generosity not only produces dignity, not only gives people back their dignity and their identity, but it produces loyalty. And you're going to have some of the most loyal people helping you fulfill what God is called you to fulfill in this place. It says the Lord. Father, from the top of their head to the sole of their feet, touch them right now in the name of Jesus, never to be the same in the name of Jesus. Just begin to worship him. 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 Worship him. Worship him right now. I don't know about you, but see, when I was speaking over them, that word was now in the atmosphere. That means that this church has a responsibility to help them see that word fulfilled. Come on, church. Because that word is just for Pastor Warren, Pastor Philip. That word is for this entire body. Because he is the leader of this body. And his blessing is your blessing. Come on. He's an old man. I know he's an old man. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Because he is releasing what God gave him to bless you. And church, I'm telling you, this is going to, 2017 is going to be a year where all of a sudden God's going to pour out like he's never poured out before. Why? I'm not just saying a popcorn prophecy. God wants you to begin construction on your new building. Because why? He is going to fill the church. He is going to fill it with himself. And then he's going to fill it full of people and in the care of his presence.
Amen.
And we're going to put a sign out there that says, donkeys welcome. We're going to get some donkeys. Some are going to be bound up, bust up. But when hands get laid on them, when the breath of God gets blown on them, they're going to understand, I'm carrying God. I'm carrying.
Hallelujah.
over here. Had to get one of the others.
Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
No, your brother.
Hallelujah.
My sister, could you just lay your hands on
me? Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
Eliana, could you come and help me?
Hallelujah.
Spirit of God will say this to you.
Yes.
The whole day we've been moving. Virginia, you've been going through the biggest battle of your life, and you felt like you didn't have the equipment to fight. You felt like your sword was dull, your weapons were dull because there was nobody to sharpen you, nobody to sharpen your heart, sharpen your soul. And all you could do is weep. That God told me to tell you today, daughter, I'm sharpening you. I'm sharpening your sword. I'm sharpening you.
Hallelujah.
But you went through a relationship that was very manipulative. And you went through some stuff that was very manipulative. And, you know, and but God wanted me to tell you, your sword is sharper than a sword of manipulation. And God says to you right now by the Spirit that, you know what, because you want my presence, you're moving toward my presence. People can go to church, people can play games with God, but you're not interested in playing games with God. That's not why you're here. You take God very seriously. You honor him. You respect him. He isn't just someone you can manipulate to get a healing. You want more than just a healing. You want more than just emotional wholeness. You want to live in the presence of God. And the Lord said, because of that, I'm coming to your house. You could have ran. You had every excuse, but you chose to pray through the situation. You believed that prayer was greater than the situation. So God is invading your circumstances. And I want to tell you, I want to give you this word, daughter. In the place of your humiliation and shame, God's bringing deliverance to you. God brings celebration and victory, says the Lord.
Hallelujah.
I'm giving victory in your relationship. I'm telling you by the Spirit.
Yes, Lord. Yes, oh God.
I'm reconciling things that are irreconcilable.
Hallelujah.
I'm breaking the stronghold of unforgiveness. I'm breaking
Thank you, Father.
When the enemy has tried to choke the very air out of the folks that you love, that you're going to go around, you're going to break the stranglehold of the devil on people's necks, and we can receive the breath of God through the power of forgiveness. And it's going to melt their hearts, and they're going to fall to their knees and worship God.
Yes,
I'm going to tell you by the Spirit, the Bible is coming to your house. In the name of Jesus, I'm touching your daughter right now. In the name of Jesus.
Yes,
bring healing,
yes,
bring resurrection,
yes,
bring restitution,
yes,
oh God. Bring reconciliation,
yes,
in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth.
Hallelujah. Bless you, Lord, oh God. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, Lord. Yes,
Lord. The Lord said, because you're pursuing me, the one your heart loves, I'm the one your heart loves.
Yes. Yes.
That you're not going to let anybody stop you from the miracle you bring.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
And because
yes,
of that,
God.
Today, you're going back home carrying the presence of God.
Hallelujah.
Lord Jesus, there it is.
Yes, God. Rest on your daughter, oh God.
Rest
on your daughter, oh God. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, oh God.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Come on, give God a shout. I want everyone to stand up. I want everybody to stand up all over the room. I want every head bowed, every eye closed across this room right now. I'd like our sister, if you could go to the piano, please. I would appreciate that. I want every head bowed, every eye closed. You may be in this room right now. May be in this room right now. And you say, preacher, I'm that donkey.
Come on.
I'm tied up. I'm resisting the authority of Jesus, the authority of the Word. The only thing that's resting on me is myself. But right now, this morning, I want the presence of God to rest on me. I want His saving knowledge. I want the Word to rest on me. I want truth to rest on me. Maybe you want the presence of God, but you don't want your flesh to die. Doesn't work that way. All flesh dies in the presence of God.
Amen.
Maybe you're here tonight and says, you know what, I'm like that one. My life is so crowded. My life is so crowded that when God comes knocking, I don't open the door. I've got too much furniture to have time for Jesus. If you're in that place right now, and you want to commit your life to Christ this morning, or recommit your life to Christ, if that's you, don't be ashamed. On the count of three, I want you to raise your right hand really high. 1, 2, 3. That's me. I see that hand. I see those hands all over the room right now. If you can put your hands down, I want everyone to look up. If you have raised your hand this morning and said, I want to commit to this work. I want to house the presence of God. I want to be that old man Eden. Come on. I want to carry the presence of God. If that is the cry of your heart, on the count of three, I want you to run to this altar right now. 1, 2, 3. Come right now. Hallelujah. And what happened? How come you're where that came? You had a stroke. How long ago? 6 years ago? Are you in here? Put your hands right now. Father, how many know that God wants to heal her from every infirmity right now? From every thing that has tried to hinder your body, Father, in the name of Jesus, when I lay hands on my sister, I command her nerves to be restored. I command her muscles to be restored. I command the side of her body to get feeling again, oh God. I command that she will be able to not only walk, but run. To use all of her hands, her fingers, that they would work perfectly. That nothing in her body would be hindered by the power of your Holy Spirit. And that when hands are laid on her, your power would touch her. Right now, in the name of Jesus, never to be the same again. Father, heal her right now in Jesus' name. 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 I need some of the ladies to lay hands on her right now. Come on, lay hands on her. Come on, lay hands on her. God's going to heal her right now. God's going to heal her right now. God's healing her right now. Muscles be cut whole right now in Jesus' name. This is the house of your presence.
Yes, oh God.
This is the house of your power. This is the house of your grace.
Yes, oh God. Yes, oh God. Yes, oh God. Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. I want everyone to put your hand on your heart right now. Put your hand on your heart right now. I want you to say this after me. Jesus. Here I stand.
In your presence.
This morning.
I've heard your word.
And right now. By the power of your spirit. I'm opening the door. I'm rearranging. My priorities. I'm going to house. Your presence.
Lord God,
when I'm blessed by you,
when I'm blessed by you,
I'm going to give.
I'm going to show generosity.
Because what you have done for me,
I want every household
to experience that same blessing.
Lord God,
thank you
for untying me.
When I was resistant,
disobedient.
Angry.
Irritated.
Frustrated. You untied me, God. Because you wanted to rest on me.
Because you needed me.
Thank you for wanting me. When I didn't want you. But Father. Once I heard.
You need me.
I'm running to you.
Use me, God.
For your glory.
And your honor.
Now lift your hands, Lord. Presence of God is in this place. Father, breathe on every single life. Breathe on every single man, woman,
child. Yes, oh God. Rest on everyone here this morning, oh God. Lord, I thank you, Father, for your word. I thank you, Jesus. Lord, here we are, oh God. I pray, oh God. We're lifting up our hand with an open heart. You can come and rest in us, oh God. You can come and rest in our heart. You can come and rest in our home. You can come and rest in this church, oh God, in our city, oh God. Lord, and we will carry your presence, oh God. We will be like that one leper, that we will separate ourselves, oh God, and continue to worship you, God, and thank you, oh God, for everything that you have done in our lives, oh God. We thank you, Jesus, that you have chosen us, oh God. Thank you, Father. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Father. We adore you and we worship you, God. Lord, we will carry you, oh God, into our family, into our city, into our working place, oh God. Wherever you lead us, oh God, we will carry you. Empower us this morning to untie people that we come in contact with, Lord. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Father.
I just threw this belly on the Lord spoke to me. You're
going to
tie a herd.
Hallelujah.
What a whole family.
Woo! Glory to God.
Mother, sister, brother, aunt. God brought you this morning to remind you and daughter, get ready. Because the words on your mouth are going to be more powerful than their resistance. And then God says this to you right now. You've been faithful in my house. You've been faithful with the small. You've been faithful. What seemingly is insignificant, God said is so significant. Because herds are coming to the knowledge. Because there's going to be a day when your house is going to be filled. You're going to be doing Bible study at your house. And they're going to be filled. The people that are coming to your house are going to be trained in the word. So they're going to leave your house untied. They're going to leave your house free. Why? If God is going to give you exponential knowledge of His Word and revelation. This is a time of revelation where God is going to open the eyes of your heart to understand things, because you're under His canopy of His blessing right now. And the Lord said, it's going to go beyond 90 days. It's going to go beyond the days that you can count. Because every day, these last few years, you've been waking up with a song. You've been waking up with gratitude. Because like that one leper, you pushed the pause button. You pushed the reset and fell down and worshiped Him. That's why I made you whole. And the Lord says, I've called you to make them whole. These donkeys whole. The Lord says, and puts you a part of the leadership team that I'm forming in the house of the Lord. That's going to raise up disciples, not just churchgoers. Because churchgoers come, they see 1 month, they're gone a week, they're gone 2 weeks, they're gone 3 weeks. But disciples can't wait to get in the presence of God where they can get instructed and encouraged. So they can go out and untie someone.
Yes.
Father, touch her right now by the power of your Spirit, God. Never to be the same again.
Yes.
In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Yes. Give God a shout of praise.
Yes.
Are you glad you came to church? Yes. Are you glad you came to church? Yes.